preparation problems. And for Monday, I'll put on the web the sketches of the solution. But if you want to prepare yourself, I urge you to try your best to solve as many of them as you can. Okay? So as a warm-up, let's do something elementary. So you are given two arrays, A and B, each containing n distinct numbers, and the equation x to the 8 minus x to the 4, y 4. So x to the 8 minus x to the 4, y 4. Equals, oh, is it y6? Sorry, my eyes are really bad and getting worse. So it's equals y6. Can you read it, the rest?
Plus x2, y2.
Plus x squared, y squared.
Plus
10. So you have two arrays that contain each contains n numbers, and you want to figure out if the first one contains x and the second one contains y that solve this equation as efficiently as possible in time, say n log n. How would you do this problem? What do we usually do for such type of problems? It boils down to what technique? Divide and conquer, maybe, but
data structure like a binary tree.
Data structure like binary tree, but what do we want to do usually efficiently when we are looking for something? Binary search works well, right? So what we can do? We can sort each array, right? So we have x and y in increasing order. But now, if you go through all possible x's, it's not clear how to do binary search, right? Because you have this minus element here and plus. So the trick is, when we do binary search, we rely on monotonicity, right, of function that we are using to search for. So we simply, the trick is to transform this into x to the 8 equals x to the 4, y to the 4, plus y to the 6, plus x squared, y squared, plus 10. Now, notice all the powers are even. So if y increases, what happens with the value of the right-hand side? It increases monotonically. So that's the key, why we did this trick, to make this monotonic. And now the procedure is just simple binary search. You go through all x's. So you fix first x. And then you try with the middle array, with the middle of the second array, if this value is too large, right? This is your array for y, the array B, right? And you try with the midpoint, if this value makes this larger than x to the 8, does it make sense to look for the y's that are here? No, right? So then you try the quarter, and so you can now do binary searching for y because this is monotonic. And that's the trick that works in a lot of such problems. You make this objective function monotonic, and then binary search gives you a quick answer. Yes? Okay, so the strategy is you go with x, right? one by one through all of these. So you will have n values for x to search for, right? But you want to make a saving here, not to have to try all y's. So you want to do it in a way that a single check will rule out lots of them. So if you sort the array in an increasing order, you start with the first x, and then you do binary search. You try the mid. If the mid value is makes this larger than x to the 8, you know that none of larger values will be able to solve the equation, because larger values will make this even larger. And it's already too large. Very good. Yeah, please always ask questions if I'm doing something that you don't understand.
Do you need to sort the X array?
You don't have to sort the X array, because you anyhow go through all of the. So that's a good point. I think I said you sort them both. There is no reason to sort A. You just go. That's a very good observation. You just go through all X's, because you are checking all of them. It doesn't matter in what order they appear. Okay. So let's see the next one. So for the next one, you have a table of numbers that has the following property. So say it's a table of whatever, say n times n, right? And each cell contains a number, but what you know is that the sequences, both rows and the columns, are increasing. So both rows, they are increasing. So the values increase this direction, right? Or they increase, this direction, and they also increase that direction. So if you have aij, you know that it is smaller than aij plus 1. Let me write it like this. Aij is smaller than aij plus 1. So this way they increase. And also aij plus 1 j is aij is smaller than aij plus 1 j, right? So the numbers increase both in this direction and that direction. So you are given such a table, and given integer, say, whatever integer, capital N. You want to figure out in linear time if the table contains n or not, right? So the idea is a little bit similar to this one. So what is the idea here? The algorithm was made fast because a single comparison ruled out a whole bunch of numbers, right? Here, if you try searching, you know, you go this way until you, if you exceed n, you step back. And then you try this way. But then if you exceed n, of course, you know the number cannot be here, but it can be anywhere here. So if you keep checking by in all the rows, you might end up with, you would end up in general with quadratic runtime. What is a number in the table that a single comparison with n will rule out either a whole row or a whole column? Yes?
The upper right-hand corner.
Brilliant. Exactly. So here is a number that is the most useful, because if your number is larger than, so let's go, this is the number. So the strategy is compare n with a1n, right, with this number here. If n is larger than this number, which numbers are automatically ruled out? Exactly. Everything in the first row will be too small. If your number is smaller than this number here, what is being ruled out? All, exactly, the entire column, right? So you keep checking with this corner value. In each move, you remove either an entire row or an entire column, right? So say if you remove the entire row, you will be comparing with this number. If you remove the entire column, you would be comparing with that number. So in this way, a single comparison removes n many of them. There are altogether n columns and n rows. So with less than 2n comparisons, you will find, you will figure out whether you have your value or not. So this is the theme in which you find comparisons both here and here that allow you to throw away a large collection of candidates. So sorry, say it again.
Is it always the top right?
Yes, always the top right.
If it's sorted in the other way, then it's
not. Then, of course, it will flip. Okay. Okay, so any questions? Yes. Sorry? Let's see. Does every corner look the, so say if we compare with say this one, then if it's too small, you rule out this. If it's too large, you cannot rule out this because there might be still there. So looks like this is the
lower left corner.
Maybe let's see. If you compare it with this one, and it is, oh, this corner. Let's see whether it works, this corner. So if it's too large, you can throw away all of these. If it's too small, then, you can throw out all of these. So yeah, this corner is also doing the trick. Very good. I didn't notice that.
Can you make the runtime automatically?
That's a very good question. I don't know. Probably not. Probably you can cook it up that if you alternate. Yeah, I don't know. Give it a try. Okay. So here is a nice one. It's a bit tricky, but not too tricky. It's a nice divide and conquer. So this is what you have. You have a chessboard of size 2 to the n times 2 to the n. So 2 to the n times 2 to the n. And one square is missing, right? So this is a hole. And you are given dominoes that consists of three squares joined like that. Your task is to cover the entire board, of course, leaving the hole uncovered. How would you approach this problem? Well, it's, you have to come up with an explicit algorithm that does the covering. I mean, you can show that 2 to the n minus 1 mod 3 is congruent to 0. So, yes?
Maybe you could, like, divide it into, like, little squares of, like, 2 by 2.
Mm-hmm.
And then that particular square will fall into one of these 2 by 2 squares. And then you can put your domino around it.
Yeah, the trouble is that you don't know whether this guy will be kind of out of sync.
You can figure out how to like cover, say, like a 4x4 square or something. Cover most of the 2 to the n grid with like the same pattern, just like duplicated.
Well, I'm not sure.
You can make that work by treating each 2x2 square as like a mini square.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get a 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n minus 1 array of mini squares. And then a tromino with the mini squares is just like a 2 by 2, a 2 by 2, and a 2 by 2, and you can cover that with 4 normal trominos.
Aha. That's one possibility. But there is something really, really extremely simple. So if it's 2 to the n by 2 to the n, what does kind of really begs you to do? How do you get 2 to the n minus 1 out of the
divided
by 2. So now we have 4 parts. And inductively, recursively, we know we can cover this one just by calling the very same algorithm. But trouble is, these guys have no holes. So we cannot apply the recursion. How do we make them a recursion applicable to them in a very simple way? Somehow you have to generate holes, but these holes should be coverable by a single domino.
Pick the ones in the corners in the middle so that it's like.
Exactly. So just pick the one that is in the middle, put a domino here, and lo and behold, now you have 4 half-size squares, each containing just one hole, so you can call your recursive function.
So was it guaranteed that given a 2 to the n by 2 to the n grid with a single hole, it's possible?
Yes, because here is the constructive proof that it is possible. Finally, you know that it works because this algorithm, you can prove by induction that this algorithm works. So, for example, if you have 4x4 with one hole, well, clearly just one domino does it. And then inductively, if it's true for 2 to the n by 2 to the n, then it's clearly true for 2 to the n plus 1 times 2 to the n plus 1 because, voila, this is... This allows the induction step. That's a tricky one. I am not going probably to give you. It's not terribly complicated, but not too easy either. OK, multiplication of polynomials. There is really just one theme that keeps reappearing. Okay, so you have 2 polynomials of degree 6, but they have missing terms, right? So P of x is equal a0 plus a2x squared plus a4x to the 4 plus a6x to the 6, and Q of x is equal b0 plus b2 x squared plus b4 x to the 4 plus b6 x to the 6th power. And you have to compute p of x times q of x using only 7 multiplications. So if we, so what do we know? The basis of this is if you multiply polynomials of degree of degrees n and m, right? The product is of degree m plus n. How many values do we need to uniquely determine a polynomial of degree m plus n? M plus n plus 1. So thus, we need m plus n plus 1 many values to uniquely determine the product. Right, so the idea of fast multiplication is so we find p of x, say x1 up to p of x m plus n plus 1, and you find q of x1 up to q of x m plus n plus 1, right? So you simply evaluate. Notice evaluation doesn't involve any large number multiplications because we choose, what values do we choose for x's? So, yeah, so choose choose as small by absolute value x i's as possible. Right? How many L's in small? 2 L's. Yeah, so because X I's are really small, if you compute, say, if P of X is equal to A0 plus A1X plus, ANX to the N, then, for example, p of 0 is simply a0. P of 1 is just a0 plus, an. This involves only addition. In fact, all of these evaluations just produce a linear combination of the coefficients with small, with constant size coefficients because these are small. So, what is then the total number of multiplications? Here we did m plus 1 multiplication, sorry, m plus n plus 1 multiplications in order to obtain, so say r of x is equal p of x times q of x. So we obtain r of x1 simply by multiplying p of x1 times q of x1. So this is the only multiplication genuine multiplication that takes place when you find the products, and all the way up to R of X M plus N plus 1, that's just the multiplication of the corresponding values of P and Q. So this is X M plus N plus 1 times Q of X M plus N plus 1. Once you get these values, you remember from the lecture notes, the coefficients of R are simply a solution of a system of m plus 1 equations, and solving this system doesn't involve any multiplication of the coefficients. It's just a linear combination of the coefficients. So it's all doable in linear time, and here we have just m plus 1 multiplications. But the problem is if the two polynomials have holes, meaning that some of the terms are missing, some of the powers of x are missing, then of course this method might be suboptimal, because here, for example, you will have you would need 13 values to determine the product, because the product is of degree 12. But obviously, you need fewer coefficients. Right? So how do we reduce this problem to the standard method of multiplying polynomials? You just substitute, that's right. So you just make two polynomials, P star of y, which is just equal to a0 plus a2y plus a4y squared plus a6y cube, and Q star y, which is b0 plus b2y plus b4y squared plus b6y cube. How many multiplications do you need to multiply these guys? Just 7 multiplications. Once you get the product, you simply replace everywhere y by x squared, and maybe do some housekeeping. So if you had x squared to the power 7, of course, this will be replaced by x to the power 14. But this, of course, is just a symbolic. So no additional multiplications are needed. So if you are given two polynomials, you somehow do some reshuffling with the purpose of making the old way of multiplying polynomials applicable. How would you multiply these two polynomials with just 3 multiplications? So let's see. So the polynomial is a0 plus, so p of x is equal to a0 plus a100x to the 100, and q of x is b0 plus b100x to 100. How do you multiply them with just 3 multiplications? Sorry? Y is equal to? Yeah, that's one. So y is equal x to 100. In fact, this would produce 2. Very good. So one option is set y is equal to x to the 100, and then you get p of y is just a0 plus a100 times y, and q of y is b0 plus b100y. So there are polynomials of degree 1. We need just three values. But rather than kind of using heavy-duty machinery, what can you directly use? Karatsuba trick, of course. You simply compute a0, b0. You compute, what do you compute? A100, b100, and you compute a0 plus a100 times b0 plus b100. And lo and behold, from these guys, so this is one multiplication, this is another one, and this is another one. But the product of this is just a0, b0 plus a100, b100 plus a0, b100 plus b0, a100. And then you can subtract these two guys, and that's precisely the coefficient that you need in the product of these two polynomials. So you don't always have to resort to heavy artillery if a sort of simple trick can. Okay, so now the perennial question, what do I expect you to understand and to be able to do regarding the devil FFT, right? So you will be tested only on whether you understand how FFT works. You won't be asked any, you know, signal processing. So just, you have to, what does it mean that you understand how FFT works? Well, it means that you have to understand what the roots of unity are and how you manipulate them. And you just have to understand basic divide and conquer of FFT, right? The fact that you form a polynomial of even degrees, a polynomial of odd degrees, you pull out one x from all odd degrees, and you get two polynomials, both of even degrees. So they are polynomials of half degree in x squared. And you have to know that as x ranges through all roots of unity of order n, x squared will range only through the roots of unity of order n over 2. So you reduce the problem of size n to two subproblems of size n over 2, plus linear overhead, which is necessary to put the two partial solutions together, because you have to multiply, you know, this x that you pulled out from odd degrees will range through all of the powers, so you will have a linear many and many multiplications. So the recurrence is t of n is 2 times t of n over 2 plus linear overhead, and we know that this has a solution n log n. So make sure that you understand what roots of unity are. So let's see, let's just do some basic calculation with roots of unity. So you have I times omega 64 to the 13 on the middle board. Okay. Okay, let's give it a shot with the middle board. Okay, so what is the expression? It is I times omega 64 to the power 13 times omega 32 to the power 11. So, and you have to find all the case that satisfy that this is equal omega 64 to the power k. Yeah? So when we have this kind of heterogeneous roots of unity, and we have to multiply them, we know that roots of unity of the same order are easily multiplied. Right? So how do we reduce this all to the roots of unity of order 64? Okay, so this part here is easy by cancellation lemma. That's omega 64 to the power 22, right? Because cancellation lemma says that you can divide the exponent on the base by the same number. This is already in good shape, but how about I? I is not in the form of a root of unity. What is I? Is it, what is the second root of unity? Negative one and one, right? So what is then I? Is I a root of unity? Is there a power that you can take I to get one? Exactly, so I is omega four to the first power, right? So it's the fourth root of unity. So how do we represent it as the power of the root of unity of order 64? So that's 16. And now things are much easier, because now what you have is that the left-hand side is equal to omega 64 to the power 16 times omega 64 to the power 13 times omega 64 to power 22. And what is this equal to? This is equal to omega 64 to 16 plus 13 plus 22. Is it 51? Okay, so this is omega 64 to the power 51. So now, when is this? So this has to be omega 64 to some power k. Can we conclude from here that k is equal to 51? No. What is? Exactly. So you have that k is equal to 51 plus 64m for every m. Because then you would get essentially k minus 51 has to be integer multiple of 64. Good. So the other thing is, what is FFT useful for evaluating? What's the convolutions? So all I want you to be able is to recognize when a sequence is a convolution sequence. So here you have f of m equal to the sum when I and j range between 0 and n, and I plus j is equal to m. And then you have here this expression log of j plus 1 to the power I. Why is this a convolution? Exactly, I can be pulled out, so this is essentially the sum of I times log j plus 1. So if you define sequence S of k to be just k, and sequence well, whatever, P of K, which is equal log K plus 1, then the sequence FM, right, this sequence is simply, so this is your sequence S, and this is your sequence P. It's simply S convolved, linear convolution with P. Okay, so this is a linear convolution of the two sequences. And so how would you explain then the algorithm? You will simply take the DFT using FFT. You can evaluate the DFT of S padded with zeros, with n minus 1 zeros, right? And the same, you pad also the sequence P with zeros. You find discrete Fourier transforms using FFT. You multiply the product term by term, right? Element by element multiplication of the two sequences, and then you take inverse Fourier transform, inverse discrete Fourier transform to compute the elements of the sequence, right? So this would be, so of course you don't have to, you just explain how you do it, how you evaluate the convolution, and you identify what sequences you are convolving. Sorry? Well, that's the tricky, I mean, that's sometimes maybe can be a bit trickier. In fact, there were even some, maybe I'll give you, I'll cook up, there was once on International Programming Olympiad a problem that was supposed to be solved by convolutions, a little bit trickier. So I'll try to dig it out and add it to this list. So this list you can find on the course web page. Again, I had to put it on the front page, but my admin will move it to the assignments page. Okay, so, Alex, yes?
What is K?
What do you mean, what's K where?
K is just
the index of the sequence. So your sequence is, it's just a dummy variable, it's a sequence. So sequence S is the sequence of all SKs such that K ranges between 0 and N, sorry, like this, right? So it's just index, right? Because this is a sequence, so you have to know what's the first, second, third element, and so forth. And the same applies, and also P is just PK. Sometimes we write it like this. When K is between 0 and N. So it's just a dummy variable index, as M is also, right? It's just the mth element of the sequence. Sometimes there are problems. In fact, one of the problems in your textbook is you are asked to produce something that is not a whole convolution, but only a subsequence of the convolution, but you can easily identify which subsequence you have to take. Okay, so let me now. Okay. So next is a bunch of greedy algorithms. So let's see which one we will tackle. Let's do the change one. So, yes.
When you're doing that, once you get to that step, after that, you're just saying that you're using FFT to find it afterwards?
Yeah.
And that's all that you have to do?
Well yeah. I mean, this is
like
done.
You have to go through the steps of all of FFT as well?
No. So if, okay, you might be asked as a simpler question to perform by hand to a computer FFT of a simple short sequence, right? To kind of show that you understand how FFT works. But of course, in general, everything that we did in class, you can just quote it, right? You can say using such and such algorithm, then okay, so this is how is convolution evaluated? So what is a convolution? Convolution of two sequences is simply the sequence of the coefficients of the polynomial, which is product of the polynomials with coefficients first sequence and polynomial with coefficients second sequence, right? So now, instead of doing term by term multiplication that is quadratic, right? How do we do that? We evaluate these two polynomials at roots of unity because we know then the product is doable in linear time. So Fourier, discrete Fourier transform has this wonderful property that it reduces computation of the convolution quote unquote in time domain, namely between sequences, into multiplication of the discrete Fourier transforms. So you see, this is the picture. Let me just do it here and then I'll move back here. So you have two sequences here. One is A0, A1, A2, and so forth. And the other is B0, B1, B2, and so forth. You see, now the convolution, so this is sequence A, this is sequence B. A convolve with B has terms that look like this, A0, B0, then A1, B0 plus B1, A0, and then the next one will be A2, B0 plus A1, B1 plus plus A0, B2, and so forth. So if you computed it directly, you would end up with quadratic many multiplications. But the fundamental property of the DFT, which we compute efficiently, so DFT is a transformation of the sequences, right? If you here have a sequence, let's call it FA, and here you have sequence FB, what are these two sequences? They are just the values of these polynomials cooked up from A and from B, evaluated at the roots of unity. Then convolution here reduces to pointwise multiplication. So it will be just F of A and then zeroth coordinate f of b, zeroth coordinate, and you simply multiply. So the DFT reduces, so DFT reduces convolution here to pointwise multiplication of the discrete Fourier transforms. And of course, pointwise multiplication is doable in linear time. And then you just get back the original, the coefficient form by applying inverse discrete Fourier transform, right? So that's the whole point of fast computation on of convolution. Term by term multiplication that is quadratic is replaced by coordinate wise multiplication of the discrete Fourier transforms here, which is doable in linear time, of course, and then going back. So the only expensive parts are computing DFT and IDFT, which we know runs in time n log n, right? But here multiplication is just 2n plus 1 many multiplications that are pointwise. So that's the whole purpose of computing, the whole trick how convolution is computed in a fast way by transforming the two sequences into that engineer call it by moving to frequency domain. Then doing regular multiplication, coordinate-wise multiplication, and then inverting using inverse discrete Fourier transform. Of course, all of these two and that one, are computed using the FFT. So notice, DFT is a transform. FFT is just an algorithm, it's not a transform. FFT is an algorithm for efficient computation of the DFT. So only DFT is transform, FFT is simply an algorithm for computing DFT. Okay, let's make a short break. And we will continue with greedy. Okay, so just I had lots of questions about the FFT. Just you don't have to memorize anything. Just remember there are kind of two transformations going on. You have sequences and you cook up polynomials with the coefficients that are these terms, right? And then what you simply do is you evaluate these polynomials at roots of unity of sufficient order. So here you will get the sequence of the values of these two polynomials. Now the product polynomial has values that are product of this times this, right? Because if you have a polynomial that is product, then when you replace the variable with particular value xi, you see that the value of the product is product of the two corresponding values. So here you just multiply term by term, term by term, and then you take inverse Fourier transform to compute the coefficients. Right? So you don't have to memorize, just keep in mind this mental picture. Coefficients become polynomials. Polynomials are evaluated at roots of unity. These values are multiplied pairwise, right? And then in this way you obtain a sequence whose inverse Fourier transform is what you need. Okay, let's do greedy now. So in every country, the coins and banknotes are always chosen so that greedy algorithm works. That's precisely how the values are chosen. So let us now show that Australian coins are chosen with the right, in the right way. So you have coins that are $2, right? You have $1, then you have 50 cents, then you have 20 cents, then you have 10 cents, right, is it? And you have 5 cents and 1 cent. Do we have 1 cent anymore? No, okay. 5 cents. Okay, so the claim is that these denominations were chosen precisely so that the greedy algorithm for returning change works. What is the greedy algorithm? If you want to give out as few coins as possible, and you have certain amount to give back, you always use as many coins of the largest possible denomination as possible, and then you continue with smaller denominations. So you always use the largest possible denomination. Yes?
Is this the same as firstly choosing all 5 cent coins and then merging them up?
Sorry, say it again.
If would it be the same if we just chose all 5 cent coins and then merged them?
Yeah, you can you merge them as much as you can. That's exactly the same. Okay, so now let's prove that indeed what greedy produces is optimal. Right? How do we show that what greedy produces is optimal? Well, we assume counterpositive, there is something better that it's not greedy but uses fewer coins. What does it mean? It means that after a while, greedy will be violated, which means certain amount you can use a larger coin, but that method used a smaller denomination. So to make this interesting, assume that the greedy fails that the method, it's really the same argument, the subset of the argument that we are going to show, assuming that the that greedy failed already at the denomination of $2. What does it mean? It means that you have certain amount x that is bigger or equal than $2, but you decided not to use $2. Right? Now, the trick is the following. So this method must have used the smaller nodes. Now, my claim is this optimal method cannot use more than one $1 coin. Why is this so? Why this optimal method cannot use more than one $1 coin? Exactly. If it used two $1 coins, it wouldn't be optimal, because you can replace these two $1 coins with a single $2 coin and reduce the number of coins for one. So the method, the amount wouldn't be, the number of coins wouldn't be optimal. What does it mean? Well, at least $1 now worth. So in the next step, we have left more than or equal $1, right? But that is not returned using $1 coin, right? Because we had two, we can use at most one of these. So at least we would have a leftover amount y bigger or equal than $1, but we don't use $1. Now, again, by the same reasoning, how many 50 cents coins could this optimal way use? Only one. Thus, my leftover amount z will be bigger or equal than 50 cents. And 50 cents is not used. OK. Now, let's see. With 20 cent coins, now things become a little bit more complicated. So how many 20 cent coins we can use? Well, there are options. 0, 20 cents. There is option 1, 20 cent, or 2, 20 cent coins. So now, if I use 0 20 cent coins, then I would have to give 50 cents with only 10 and 5 coins. But how many 10 cent coins I can use? Just one. And how many 5 cent coins? Just one. That adds up to 15, so I cannot give these 20 back, right? So now, here, if I have one 20 cent coins, then I'm left with at least 30 cents, and I have to use only 10 and 15, right? Again, I can use only one 10 cent coin, and I would be stuck with 20 cents to return with 5, and that's obviously suboptimal. If I use two 20 cent coins, then I am left with z bigger or equal than 10 cents, right? But can I use now 10 cent coin? I'm using two 20 cent coins, and I'm left with at least 10 cents. Can I use a 10 cent coin? I'm using two 20 cent coins. If I use 10 cent coins, what I can do? What can I do? Replace it with one 50 cent coin. So I cannot use, and I have to use only 5 cent coins, but obviously I have to use at least two of them, and that would be replaceable by a 10 cent coin. So you see, Australian money was in fact chosen to allow return by greedy, to return the amount by greedy in an optimal way. Also, American coins Now, can you think of the nominations when greedy would fail? Yes. Well, you have to show that it's optimal. So one way of doing it is counterpositive to derive contradiction. Most of the time it reduces one or the other way by, for example, cut and paste to a contrapositive. Yeah.
Compare the ratio of the coins that you need to.
Well, you have to really give a tight argument. I'm not sure how you would do it if you compare the ratios. It has to be kind of bulletproof algorithm, bulletproof proof. Okay, so how about what would be obvious combinations? Yes?
So 1 cent, 3 cent, and 4 cent coins.
1 cent, 3 cents, and 4 cents, and what is the amount?
Six.
That's very good. So if I have 6 cents and I use greedy, I would be left with 2 cents to return, and I would have to use 2 1-cent coins, right, which is altogether 3, while I can actually use 2 3-cent coins to return. There is, in fact, a mathematical characterization of what the sequence has to satisfy for greedy to work, but it's kind of pretty complicated, and to get it, so we won't go there. Now, with the very same argument, we can show that greedy works also for the following denominations: wine, 5, 25, 125, in general, 5 to the k for k from, say, you can go between 0 and whatever number you want, n. Greedy works for this denomination. How would we prove that greedy works? How? It's again always the same story, right? Assume that there is a better way of returning money than greedy. What does it mean? It means that at one point x you had amount bigger than 5 to certain point, certain power m, but you did not use a 5 to the m coin. If you didn't use 5 to the m coin, you must have used the largest denomination available to you was 5 to the m minus 1 coin. How many of these coins, optimal, this allegedly optimal way, can use? All at most 4. Why at most 4? Why can't you use 5? Exactly. If you used 5 coins of denomination 5 to m minus 1, you can replace them by a single coin of denomination 5 to the m. Yes?
Can you do it in another way where you just put the denomination in base 5 and then prove it through there without contradiction?
The thing is, how would you prove it without contradiction? I mean, yeah, you know, it's... essentially, for any value to a certain power, for any base 5, what is actually greedy? How would you describe the amount x that you have to give if your coins are d to some of two integers k? What are actually the number of coins of each denomination that you have to give?
Digits.
In that basis, in that base, right? So they are just the digits, right? If you have 3 times 5 to the k plus, say, 2 times 5 to the k minus 1, 3 and 2 and so forth are just the digits in base 5. Okay, so, and now the argument goes, because you can use at most four of these, you are left out with at least five to the m minus one amount, z bigger or equal, right? And again, you can use at most four coins of denomination, five to the m minus two, and you are always, eventually, you will have some value w bigger or equal than five, and you will have to use more than, you will have to use at least five 1 cent coins, and this is, of course, suboptimal. So you just kind of propagate the leftover, and you show that it cannot be optimal. Okay. So let's see what. Okay, here is a simple and nice typical greedy problem. So you have a bunch of intervals, okay? You have a bunch of intervals, and you want to find a minimal size tiling. What is a tiling? A tiling is a subcollection of these intervals whose union covers the entire range from min to max, okay? How would you choose tiling that has as few elements as possible? So you have to, start with the left end. Among all intervals that start on the left, right? So these are, this is the big interval, and here you have a bunch of intervals, and you look, you of course have to start with those that you have to cover the end. Among all intervals that start here, which one would you choose?
The one that ends the first.
The one that ends the first. Now the aim is to produce as few, not as many intervals. Of course, one that protrudes the farthest, then of course you look at all intervals that starts before this interval ends, and again from them you choose one that throws as far as possible. And now a simple, I'll leave it to you to practice, show by exchange or by a counter positive that cut and paste, right, that this indeed produces optimal optimal covering with the smallest amount. Okay, how about if you have also a bunch of intervals, but you want to take the largest subcollection that is disjoint? How would you do that? How would you take the largest collection that is disjoint? How do you pick the intervals? So you have a bunch of intervals, right, of the real line that partly overlap. You want to choose the largest collection of these intervals that are pairwise disjoint. Yes?
When you say the largest, do you mean sum of the lengths or just?
No, just the largest in cardinality, as many as possible that are disjoint. Exactly. So that's a different disguise of the same problem. You will simply start with the interval that ends earliest, right? Then you eliminate all conflicting intervals, and you pick for your next interval, again, interval that ends the earliest. and you keep doing that. Okay, so here is another a little bit more complicated. So again, given a collection of intervals, choose the subcollection with as few elements as possible. Such that they intersect all other intervals. Sorry? So you are given a collection of intervals, right? Just like before. You want to choose as few of them as possible so that for every interval from this, from the entire system, it is intersected by at least one of the chosen intervals, right? So you have a large collection of intervals. Okay, I'll erase my version of English if you don't like it. Okay. You're so picky, you know, a few articles missing here and there, a few misspellings, and you are immediately upset. I mean. Okay, people. Nerds are supposed to use incorrect English, okay? I'm just joking. Okay. So you have a collection of intervals, and you want to select as few of them as possible. Say we select this one, and then we select, say, this one. And then we select, for example, this one. And I claim there are only three of them, yet every interval, every other interval is intersected by at least one of the chosen intervals. Say this one is intersected by this one. This one is also intersected by this one. This one is intersected by this, and so forth. Every interval, if I'm not mistaken, yep, also this one is intersected by this. So all the intervals are intersected by at least one of the... What would be... So how would you go about, yes? Let's see. So in order, so which interval shall we start considering? One that ends the first. So if we consider one that ends the first, but we don't have to choose it, maybe there is a better interval that intersects it.
Choose the interval which intersects as many other intervals that haven't already been intersected.
Okay, so for homework and for practice, show that this won't work. Now, it's extremely good. Look, it's extremely natural idea. You want to use as few as possible in choose one that intersects as many of them as possible, show that this method might fail to produce the smallest. It's non-trivial. You will have to play with intervals a little bit, but it's extremely important. You know, there are tempting ideas that might not actually work, and this is why you need a rigorous argument to show that what you want to do is correct. So try at home. So what do I want you to do? Assume that you pick always interval that intersects as many other intervals as possible. Remove all the intersected intervals and continue in this manner. Yes?
Can you use memoization?
Well, okay, so you have to make sure that you do it in a way that you can prove that it produces the shortest such. So let's argue. You see, you look at the interval that ends first. This interval, either you take it, or you have to take an interval that intersects it. Now, among all, including that interval, and all intervals that intersect it, what do you think, which one is the best to choose? That finishes the latest, exactly. So you will start with an interval that finishes the first. You have to cover it somehow. So you look at all intervals, right, that intersect this interval that ends first. If there are none, then of course you have to take this interval, right? But among all intervals, if there is such, that do intersect that interval, you will pick one that ends as late as possible, that throws as far as possible, right? Then remove all intervals that are intersected by that interval, and again look at among the remaining intervals, one that ends first. You have to take care of it, so you look at all intervals that intersect that one that ends first, and you again pick one that ends as late as possible, right? So at each stage of the construction, you look at the interval that ends among the remaining intervals that ends first. Then among all intervals that intersects that interval, you pick one that ends as late as possible, and this is the picked one, and you keep doing that. Again, it's a rather simple exercise for your home. Prove the optimality again by the very same idea. You show, assume that there is a better that is not obtained by greedy. Find the first place where it differs from greedy, and then show that you can cut and paste, that you can swap the chosen interval with the one that ends the latest, and make this solution compliant one step more with the greedy. After finitely many steps, you will transform this whole system into the greedy solution, contradicting that the one that you started with is better than greedy. So it's, look, it's really, really, really more of the same. That there is a very limited amount of tricks. Sometimes it's maybe a little bit more complicated than. Than just completely obvious construction, but the number of tricks are actually rather small. Okay, now there are two that are actually a bit trickier, but they are proved as theorems in your textbook. So these are the graph ones, one that is called the cut property. So let's look briefly at them. So what is the cut property? So assume that you have a graph. So you have a graph G, and you split all the vertices into two disjoint subsets. So they are x and all the vertices minus x. And then you look at all edges whose one end is in x and the other end is in the complement of x. Find one of the smallest weights. So this is a weighted happy with English? weighted graph G and partition of V into two sets. V is equal, well, if you want, say, X union Y, such that X intersected with Y is empty. And E is minimal weight edge. Such that, E is vertex, the ends are U and V, such that U belongs to X and V belongs to Y. You have to show that this edge must belong to every minimal spanning tree for this graph. Of course, if all weights are distinct, then there will be only one minimal spanning tree, and you have to show that this edge belongs to the minimal spanning tree. This property is called the cut property for graphs, right? So how do we show that? Right, so we have our picture. Here is X, and here is Y, and here is one edge, E, that is of minimal weight. We have to show that it belongs to the spanning tree, minimum spanning tree. How do we do that? So because we have a minimum spanning tree, going along the edges of this spanning tree, there will be a path between these two vertices. So you will have a path that goes from U to V. What do we look now to show a contradiction if edge E was not chosen? How would you derive a contradiction? Remember, E was chosen to be minimal weight edge whose one end is in X and the other end is in Y. How do we now get a contradiction? Which edge do we consider that will cause problem? You see, this path starts in X and finishes in Y. So if you follow this path, what do you have to arrive at? What kind of edge? A bridge, exactly. That you will hit eventually one edge that has one end in X and the other end in Y. But that would be now a contradiction because if you replace this edge with our edge E, right, you will get a spanning tree of smaller weight, right? Because this will be two disjoint components of the graph that are joined now with E, and this E will have smaller weight than this, and that's the only edge that we are changing. So voila, we got a contradiction. So if E is a smaller weight, smallest weight edge across a partition, or as it's called, across a cut in the graph, it has to partake in the minimal spanning tree. So this tells us what edges must be included in minimal spanning tree. Now let's see the other side of the coin. What edges must be excluded from minimal spanning tree? So this is also a problem on the list. And again, you have a weighted graph G and cycle C in G. Let E be an edge of that cycle of largest weight among all edges of the cycle. Prove E cannot belong to a minimum spanning tree T. So no spanning tree can contain an edge from a cycle that is of largest possible weight. How do we prove that? So you have a cycle in the graph and say this edge E is a weight of this edge E is the largest among all the edges of the cycle. And we have to show that E cannot belong to a minimum spanning tree. Why is this so? Well, assume that there exists a minimum spanning tree that in fact contains this edge. So here is our edge E, and in fact it happens to belong to a minimum spanning tree. Somehow we have to derive an inconsistency, right? So if I remove this edge from my graph, the whole spanning tree will break up into two subtrees, right? It will break into X and Y. So I removed my edge E, right? How would you now derive a contradiction from the assumption that this edge was in fact a part of minimal spanning tree?
You can probably choose an edge connecting two parts because E actually has the largest weight, and it doesn't matter.
Exactly. So now we know that E is a part of a cycle. So there will be a path between U and V. Now, What, again, the same trick, which edge am I going to consider? So when I remove this edge E, my tree disintegrates into two subtrees. But I know that this edge is part of a cycle. So if I step from U to V, when do I stop? Which edge of this cycle do I choose? Well, at least one of the edges will have one end in X and the other end in Y. But now this edge has smaller weight than E, because E was the edge in the cycle with largest possible weight. So if I, instead of this edge, if I include now that edge, I would get a spanning tree with lower weight, which is impossible, which is a contradiction by our assumptions. Okay, let's just do another one that uses these tricks. So you remember last time we did a problem in which we had a graph with minimal spanning tree and we added additional vertex and found a linear time algorithm that updated the minimum spanning tree for the new graph. Let's now do the same with edges. So assume that I have my minimum spanning tree, and for a graph G, and then to the graph G, I add another edge, say this edge that wasn't present before. Now the question is, when is the old spanning, minimum spanning tree, also minimum spanning tree for the whole graph? What do you think? When will this happen? When will I not need to revise my minimum spanning tree? Yes? Not necessarily minimum spanning tree, but minimal edge in the loop, right? So there can be, because E is an additional edge, right? And this spanning tree is, of course, connected. It will form a loop. And if E is the longest edge on that loop, do I have to revise my spanning tree? No, because we just proved that the longest edge across any cycle cannot belong to any spanning tree. So there can be no spanning tree for extended graph that contains E. So old tree works. What happens if E is shorter than some other element of the loop? Exactly, you delete that edge, and you include N, this E, and voila, you get the updated tree. Okay, please try to do as many problems as you can. Now, the textbook contains heaps of problems and also heaps of solved examples. Go through all of them. Now, on Monday, if I can have your attention, on Monday I'll try to organize extended office hours in a big classroom so that, and I'll post it on the web and send email so that you can ask me questions.